Okay. So first of all, just a few words about Ficita, because maybe most of you don't know Ficita. Ficita is a worldwide organization based on two pillars. You have on the left of the slide, the society members. So all the society of engineers all over the world. So France, Germany, Italy, US, Japan, Korea, etc. On the right of the slide, the corporate members. So corporate members are companies that are joining our society in order to share knowledge and to have some exchanges, whatever they are informal or whatever they lead to white papers, etc. Of course, we have some links with academics, and we will be very happy to have more with your laboratories to you belong to. And of course, we have also some special links or dedicated links with the bodies that are in line with more governmental issues. What are we doing? We are doing what almost all association are doing. So paper and publications. So of course, a dedicated workshop, Next Generation Engineers, some online conferences. So more and more online. And now since last year, we are only online conferences related to either technologies or way of working. Mobility topics we are more focusing today are more related to our enlarged ecosystem. You have at the bottom of the slide all the industry factor we address, so infrastructure, roads, payment, parking, insurance, smart grid, that are on top of our automotive industry, and the use cases that we have to put from technical point of view we have to use in order to deliver the right service. So those are the topics where we are focusing in the 2 years to come. My purpose today will be in three parts. So first of all, save the planet, then save the people, and then technology and ecosystem for enriched experience related to those two main topics. So first of all, regarding save the planet, so we have to think about what is the context today and the awareness, and what are the new metrics we have to use in order to be sure that we will cope with all the constraints the planet has. So I don't want to speak about opportunities. I want to speak about what are the limitations for economic growth from our industry point of view. First of all, on the left of the slide, what we can see is the fact that fossil energy is going to decrease from 2030 to 2050, and then even more after. While in fact is raising too much compared to what is allowed. So energy will be limited while climate is warming. Another thing is related to the material we are using. We used to talk about semiconductors, where there is a big crisis in the automotive industry that is in fact impacting a lot the sales of the car. But I don't speak about that. I would speak only about raw materials. And I'll take the example of copper. Why? Because in fact, those materials are more and more rare on our planet, and we have to spend more and more energy to get them. So it is a sort of a non-virtuous circle related to these raw materials we have to use. In that sense, what we can see with the example of the copper is that even if we are recycling by 90% this material, in fact, it will be there is a big increase of the needs. And in the same way, in the same time, we have a big increase also of the energy which is needed according to the fact that the ores are no more available. What is the result? The result is that energy use in road transport is dominated by electrification and vehicle efficiency. What is the progress is coming from both simultaneously. The fact that the industry is progressing in efficiency, so the yield of the technologies we are embarking, and also by electrification. So what you can see on this slide is a sort of assessment of what will come in terms of electrified kilometers. So business as usual is the green curve. And then we have a more rapid one, which is in line with when governments are asking or are putting incentive, etc. So it could be the case of Europe. So governments are pushing, and the blue curve is related to when on top of the government incentive, in fact, you have a behavior of the society which is pushing much more on the net zero emissions. So Europe, for example, would be between orange and blue, and maybe Japan is still on a green curve. But at the end, keep in mind that progress is coming from the two items, efficiency of the technology and electrification. Regarding the fact that we are in the constraints of CO2 all over the world, we have to change our metrics and to be sure that what we are measuring is really the full impact of the materials we use and the energy we use to put those materials being efficient in our cars. And then also taking into account, of course, the use of the car during its lifetime. So what you can see in this slide is the fact that according to the country and according to the way the energy is produced, in fact, CO2 is not at all the same when we are talking about electrification. And you have the comparison for each country between BEV and ICE in different countries, knowing that, in fact, if we are in a country where we use a lot of not so much nuclear energy, such as in UK or in France, of course, the impact of CO2 will be much more important when we are talking about battery manufacturing. So what is at stake is this kind of measurement all over the life cycle and from way of doing, in fact, approaching the design in a different way. That is to say the four R's. Four R's is reduce. So reduce the weight, reduce the materials we are using as a minimum, of course, taking into account the needs and the request for the vehicle at the end. A lot of reuse. So for example, after one life, I put the example of a startup company who is taking a second life battery and putting them in trucks where you can use them to cool or to cook, etc., as a second usage. Also recycle, so it was something that already exists, but we have to push it at a maximum, much more in reusable plastics, same as all the materials that we are using in the battery, especially on the electrode. And the last item is to renew. So it's to changing the raw material approach. Instead of using some material coming from the earth, trying to use as much as possible some materials that are biosourced. That's why Michelin is trying to do. So the way of doing is changing, the measurement is changing if we want to reach what we want to do related to the climate warming. Now, the context related to the people. What is happening? In fact, it is not changing a lot. What we can see in the worldwide context is that if you are in a low-income or medium-income country, you would have much less change and to be safe than in, of course, high-income countries. So it is always the same thing. 90% of the fatalities on the roads occur in low-income and middle-income countries when they have less than half of the registered card on the roads. So it is something that is not changing. And what we can see is that our global system, including infrastructure, because when we are talking about safety on the road, we must also include the road system. In fact, we are progressing less than the others, I can say, the others issues from a people point of view. And it is what WHO, World Health, is thinking about us, that we will come from the 9th position to the 5th position. So we have to speed up. And the way to speed up for us is the way to work much more with the infrastructure while we are also progressing on the cars. And it is something that we are going to see. Car in the city, we have to say, is of course the safest way to move. In fact, pedestrians, cyclists, motorcycles are the most, it is obvious, huh? But we have the figures in order to demonstrate that they are the most vulnerable road users. And as we share the road, we have to be sure that road fatalities now are about 80% vulnerable users. And of course, you have 10 more chances to be hurted if you are not in a car. Regarding that, in the car, what is or out of the car, what is changing in terms of fatalities? What we can see is that there are some changing in the demographic. So more senior drivers more senior drivers because they are switching from commuting on a long distance, etc. And they are more, they are older, so that we have to protect them maybe more. Distraction is something that is coming, it's becoming very important. So people who are looking at their smartphone, etc., whatever they are in the car or in the street or in their bicycles. So it is something that is becoming very risky. Speeding and drinking driving. So it is something that it's still an issue, even the drugs. And the new mobility form, which is encouraging sweet mobility, but sweet mobility means vulnerable users. So it is something where from ecosystem point of view, so the infrastructure or from vehicles point of view, we have to take into account. But now the figures related to what I've said. So related to the vehicle occupants, so you can see there all the countries and the progress between 2010 to 2018. It is the last figure we got. And then what we can see is that, of course, it is the progress is very high and we are still progressing related to the car. So, of course, the safer roads, as well as addition to the fleet, safer vehicles with a new system such as braking system, etc., is, of course, enriching the safety. What is more, I can say, an issue is related to pedestrian. What you could see there, and it is before COVID effect, where people are working much more, in fact, is the fact that in some countries, we have a raise, and especially in Europe, we are no more progressing the fatalities with the pedestrian. And even in US, pedestrian are increasing, pedestrian death is raised by 46%, which is a lot. So it is not a good trend. We have not the figures after COVID, but we will be sure that it will increase. So be careful with the pedestrian, and it would, of course, would have an impact on the regulation in each country where the phenomenon is occurring. Then, cyclist, same phenomenon as a pedestrian, much more, but in fact, the trend with a bicycle where I can say visible earlier. What we can see is that there are much more countries where we are not progressing. We are, in fact, increasing the number of deaths with cyclists. So maybe we have to be sure that all the systems which are related to safety of the cyclist we will have to focus on so that we will be able to decrease the number of deaths. Now, COVID impact, we have only the COVID impact related to deaths on the road. And what we can say on the roads, not in the cities, is the fact that even if the traffic, it's difficult to read, but you can have the road deaths on the first column and the traffic change in the second one. In fact, the road death decrease less than the traffic. So that maybe we have an effect of less attention. Maybe we have an effect of another mix on the road. But the fact that, of course, it decreased, but not as a proportion as the traffic. Now, what is the effect on all that, on the technologies where we are, we have to focus. So we have to focus on technologies and the ecosystem for an enriched experience compared to nowadays. So from electrification and energy point of view, safety, and from ecosystem related to the services you already talked about, Tommaso. Related to the technology, of course, first of all, electrification and energy. What is the state related to battery lithium-ion status? What you see on the right of the slide is the market share of the main suppliers of batteries. It could explain the fact that in Europe, you have a lot of incentive from government to have some plants that would build batteries. Also in US, it is coming. So why? Because you can see that it is only in Asia that you can find those companies, and especially Korea and China. What we have to take into account is the fact that a battery is very intrusive in a car, in a sense that you have the energy management system to take care about, and also the thermal management of the battery, which is impacting by far the car. Just to explain our tricky issue. Related to the safety of the battery, which is impacted by the thermal management, we have some troubles with the fires when you have too much voltage, etc., and the court circuit. What is it is in the left of the slide? You have all the technologies of lithium-ion battery, lithium-ion technologies, red, blue, green. What is coming from mainly China is another technology, which name is LFP. And we need for that from a thermal point of view, we need to see the zoom where we see again the black curve. What is showing? It's showing that you have a very different behavior between this LFP technology and those already used and already put in place in our cars, mainly in Europe, other lithium-ion technologies. And what is the consequence? The consequence is that on your platform, on your cars, it cannot be the same management at all. Neither related to the electric issue or the crash issue that, of course, have a consequence on electric. So very, very tricky. And it could lead to different platforms related to that. I will explain later on that there are other items. What is the future related to that? Is what we call solid-state lithium-ion technology. What is the interest of that? The interest is that you have the same level of energy embarked. And I say that the solid-state is the future of current lithium-ion technology, which is provided without the problem of safety with the thermal management. And what is occurring is the fact that Toyota and Bosch invest a lot on these technologies. And of course, current suppliers of batteries are also investing a lot. What is very difficult and could postpone the arrival of this technology on the market is the fact that the electrolyte is solid. In that sense, you must have a very adhesive, well bonded, I can say, or well good connection between the cathode and the anode and this electronic, so that the electron could travel, I can say, in one sense or the other. So it is the main difficulty, which is a process, process engineering issue. And currently, there are a lot of research on those aspects. It is not the only characteristic. What we have to keep in mind is this one. When we compare, I talk about LFP, so no rare material used, and current one, which is where we must have a lot of requests to achieve related to the safety, which lead to different platforms. LFP has some, we could see advantages. We have also some drawbacks. Drawback is, what is the drawback? Drawback is energy, which is not the same at all. So you can see the difference in energy per unit volume or performance. In fact, to mitigate, you have to put much more volume of your battery. And of course, your car is becoming much heavier. So that you can, LFP could be seen used for small cars, and the others could take battery, which would be at the beginning, because the curve be before the decreasing of the cost, something which should be dedicated to high range. So we see that the portfolio of each OEM would evolve, would change according to the choices made for the batteries and for the range they want to use. Same for the charge, because the charge of LFP, as is not sensible, it is not sensitive to the thermal management, you can charge much quicker compared to, in fact, current lithium-ion, where the charging is much more tricky if your thermal management is not enough accurate. Along with the battery, and the electrification of the car, we have to take into account, of course, the change of energy. And we have to talk about renewable energy. What is at stake is the fact that even if the car is progressing a lot, in Europe, for example, as you said before, we have to consider that the energy has also to switch to green energy. And I take the example of what the CIA is showing, is the fact that along with the progress of the cars, so consumption for it is a sort of assumption from 2 million to 4 million of EV cars and production of photovoltaic plants, I can say, we could have a sort of balance between them. Sometimes, according to the usage of the car, you could use the battery as a battery for energy on top of battery for the car. So it could be the case if you are not using or if you're not charging at 100% of your battery, but it must be something that you have to deal with the other part of the ecosystem, which is the energy provider, so that we can propose some contracts that allow this kind of thing. But keep in mind that we could, if we invest, we could have a sort of synchronized progress. Now, we talk about a lot of battery, but it is not an electrification, but it is not the only way. We are also talking about hydrogen, about gas, etc. So those technologies, so in order to see where there are some overlap between the technologies and where they are very different. You could see a sort of overlap when we are talking about big storage, which is needed, or big storage meaning a big autonomy, and discharge time, which is less in one day, for between hours and day, because you have to deliver the power to the powertrain, which needed to do the mobility. So in fact, it is something where we see that something is at the intersection, but there is more or less some areas where they are complementary solutions. Just to illustrate at the also not only the area of usage, but the efficiency of the usage. So when we compare efficiency chain, we can see that from the wind power to the wheel, I can say, from gas, we have 4.4%, let you see it is. With hydrogen and fuel saving percent with electric. Of course, when we are moving in winter, we are much more near between hydrogen and electric vehicles. So next to the scope of the usage, we have also to take into account the efficiency. I just show you an example, which is between the Mirai and the Tesla 3, so Mirai with hydrogen and Tesla 3 with the battery. So what we see, and we see is that we need needed for 100 kilometers with the same, 100 kilometers. On one side, we need 57 kilowatts, and on the other, it is 19.6 kilowatt from energy point of view, on the wool chain, I can say, to build the energy and then to use the energy. And we can see that, in fact, we found again the same by three, so between 12 and 24. And we see the same factor. And it leads to, in fact, the more or less the same autonomy, but with a slight different, weight difference when we are talking about Tesla Model 3, that is more or less the same weight as the Mirai, depending. Here we show that when we use in the same, context, we show that the efficiency is not the same. Of course, price is not the same, but it is only from a technical point of view. Now, we say that, in fact, electrification is one aspect, but another aspect is efficiency of the technology that is progressing a lot. Another one is related to the behavior. What we can see from the Kaya, formula applied to the mobility is the fact that the two first lines are dedicated to more or less technologies. So CO2 on energy. So it is the fact that what is the efficiency factor and the part of fossil that is used to make the energy, then the way and the yield in order to convert the energy on the car, then the use of the car, and then how many kilometers you are doing. it is a sort of global formula. And what we can see is that in order to decrease the total CO2 from a population point of view, we can play on technology, first two lines, but also on behavior, which is the last two lines. So no more one dedicated driver by car, could be also teletravail, so working at home, or it could be also smooth mobility. So this is just to say that it is not only a question of technology, also a question of behavior. And we will come back on that related to the ecosystem. Now, moving to the safety. What is changing in the safety? Do the energy put in the back, I can say, the investments on the safety and the autonomous, it is something that we are going to see. What is occurring related to intelligent safety? We went from accident mitigation, because we don't have the good behavior related to the way we were driving. And we are going to a sort of cooperative driving. We're using vehicle-to-world connectivity, humans and system integration in order to decrease road fatalities and stress reduction. So this cooperative driving, coming from protection when the development is driving, we go to some new trends, knowing that density on the road will always increase, which is very important to deal with. New trends, which are there? Rational driving, we could call that for passenger car autonomous driving. Vulnerable co-users on the infrastructure that we have to take care of. Augmented awareness, so much more contextual information we have to provide, whatever it is from the context or from the safety of the intern in the cabin, I can say. Also interfaces with multimodal mobility and electrification, where we need also to take into account the safety. So what is the challenge and challenge of the EHM, HMI, in order to be sure that in a cooperation, which is very, very difficult. It is also used for connectivity, either for safety or saving energy. It is not only used for safety. It could be used also to save energy, knowing where you want to go. Infrastructure is also equipped, so we have to work together. Same safety communication standards for public transport. If we are sharing the roads and the infrastructure, we must share the standard to address this kind of technology so that you can use them and share them and to be cheaper for everybody. And maybe the 5G or the short-range Wi-Fi doesn't matter. What is important is to share locally the intelligent transport system in a city because we would not have any business model if you are not sharing this kind of global system and infrastructure. When we are talking about ADAS and rational driving, in fact, we have, from safety point of view, we are addressing all those cases. Safe function, safety layer, etc. It is a state of the art, and each OEM and supplier and all in our industry are dealing with that. What is important as it ends from a worldwide perspective is that the fact that we share all the dangerous situation, what we call relevant traffic scenario, where there is a danger that would occur. Of course, it is not the same according to the traffic, the world, the region, the culture, etc. That is why we need a sort of a sharing database where experience is feeding the database, and as we did in the past through analysis of all the emergency situation. So it is something that we have to encourage, but now in a digital mode, instead of, I can say, physical phenomenon analysis that we were used in the past. We have some different regional approaches for the deployment according to where we stand from safety point of view. We have the two opposites. In China, all would be regulated related to the standards. In US, currently, we are just, you are just making a sort of declaration of a file where you put the evidences of your design. Europe is more or less in the middle, becoming related. So it's made for some safety services that we are putting in the car, and some are not, or augmented autonomous behavior. What is the consequence? The consequence is that vertical is the customer willingness to pay. In fact, as far as normative safety in the country is seeing a benefit to something which has been provided by a premium as a sort of a good device to reduce the fatalities, it is embarked in the regulation or state of the art. In that sense, the normative baseline is pushed up as far as we have a density effect or more vulnerable users in the car, in the shared, in the roads. So in that sense, we must, if we want to be more safe, spending less money, we have to standardize the architecture, for example, the access to the road equipment, for example, so that we could, in each region, make the right software that is complying with what is raising in each country. And why it is mandatory to do that? It is mandatory to do that because, in fact, each time you change something, you have to go specification with the changing. So either it is a demand or the evaluation method, and then coming up to through all the classical things, I can say, the classical devices, which is in the some from the software till the vehicle. Of course, dealing with ISO safety related to SOTIF, what is coming from the sensors, I can say, and cybersecurity, which is coming from connectivity. So it is huge work. So if we standardize, we could hope to spend less money. If it is standardized, and before even before that, what OEMs are doing? Regionally, in fact, there is a sort of scalable feature set approach where you combine a sensor set envelope and the CPU, which is able to monitor that. So sensor set envelope is in the car and out of the car for the sensors, the radar, etc., or the camera inside. Of course, software that from platform perspective that are gathered in order to deliver the set of devices and functions that are necessary for each region. And it is something that it has been developed. Why? Because all the C standards are not very well shared, I can say, till now. What we can say, and why it is not shared, even, 5GAA is the worldwide, I can say, association, which is related to connectivity. Around 5G. You have in this slide, on this slide, the different frequencies used by what is said as the same technology. What you can see is that, in fact, we are not doing that. And what even the CTO of this association is saying that when we compare the versions of V2X in China, Europe, and US, differences in the upper level layer protocols and security management are really important. And he said that we could do much more together. Of course, it is taking into account only road aspects, and we think that we have also to take into account urban train in the ITS, and it is not currently the case. By the way, we have some initiatives. In the US, you have an initiative known as CAVNU. What is CAVNU? CAVNU is an association of all the automotives mainly, and also newcomers such as Waymo, Argo, etc. Also using van, etc. Van, buses, trucks, etc. involved. Of course, Michigan, and they want to develop much safer roads so that, in fact, sharing all the protocols in order to have much more shared mobility and safer mobility related to goods or people. In Europe, we have another one, which name is data for safety, for road safety. So you have the, it is not only a question, it is not only corporates or companies, it is also governments that are involved in this initiative. And they are thinking about what could be a sort of mega platform, comprehensive safety traffic information system, so a platform where you share all the information related to traffic information services. So you can see that there are initiatives, they are not coordinated. And now, related to the ecosystem, from business point of view, what is coming? Public, and from business point of view, in order to make all those very expensive technologies more feasible, we have to share much more with city. So Thierry Mallet is the president of public transport in France. And what he's saying? He's saying that public transport is in an ODD, of course, known and bounded environment is a typical example where we could have much improvement using autonomous vehicles. But supervision is also needed for security, so it is inside the cabin, and even for dedicated ODD, safety is very difficult to achieve, even between 20 to 60 kilometers per hour. Because why? Because you need to make sure or to secure the context and all the crossroads and all the dangerous situations. So it is not only a question of public transport, it is a question of paths that must be secured. Is also an issue. Why? Because 65% of the employees, and it is the same worldwide, are drivers, so that we cannot switch in a second, I can say, when we are talking about that. And what are the place of the vehicles in this context? At the interface, what we can see is the fact that in some towns, such as Le Havre, for example, it is in France, so operators, such as Trandev or operators of mobility, so put buses in place in the for public transportation, but during the night, because they ask private or taxis to do the job. So usage with classical public transport, buses, etc., and when it is cheaper, cars or dedicated cars that are more dedicated to public transport, but with less people inside. In that sense, if we are not using the same ITS, intelligent traffic system, we will not be able to use the same path as the public transport. And because we are now less vehicle at home than in the past, we have to, from industry point of view, we could compensate by being a complementary way of a public transportation. And it is very important to keep this opportunity all over the world. Now, ITS and connectivity. Why do we need this IT and connectivity for the services? You see on the left of the slide, all the system in the cars. when you are talking, we are much more and more cross-domain in the car, but also out of the car. Each time we want to talk about energy management, to charge a car, to have the map in order to define the best way to save energy, in order to be sure that from adaptive cruise control, we have the emergency or the accident, etc., etc. So it is something which is now entering in our ecosystem. And when we were talking about the full measurement of what we are using in the car, maybe we have to take into account ICT also, so information system technologies. What we see is that even if this industry is making a lot of progress, when we are looking at data center, networking and consumer device. Consumer device is going to decrease according to the progress we've made, but data centers that are used for our services and networking, which is used for our connection to the V2X, is increasing by far. So we have also to work with this, with those ecosystems in order to be sure that we save the planet in the future. And what is the global view, or I can say the global picture? The global picture is that from car point of view, first row on the slide, from car point of view, we are going from, in the middle, a sort of a TCO, total cost of usage, of ownership and usage. It was the center of the way we were designed. Sustainable development goals, where we have also to take into account life cycle cost, either to manufacturing or either to recycle and after. So very important from industry point of view and from a consumer point of view, because we have customers. From customers' point of view, we went from a dedicated car, I can say, usage, to a sort of potential synergies with others, such as electricity, such as internet or the phone, in order to have to limit the cost from household and planet so that you can have more connection between all the systems. And we think that we could progress in our industry if from a society point of view, we are in line with the first row, and from customer point of view, we go more and more to what is explained in the second row. That is the way we would like to work in Fisita from a worldwide perspective. To do that, you need a lot of ecosystem. An ecosystem, here you can have, we have an example of Software Republic that has been put in place by Renault, Trapeze, which is Vinci, Nokia, and Stellantis to use a car as a complement of public transportation. So it is the case of Trapeze and Software Republic to develop services more or less. And also what is occurring also in China with Geely, for example, who build its own ecosystem since much longer time than in Europe. So you can see that it begin in 1996 with, in fact, the first passenger car, and then a real cooperation with the Volvo, etc., etc. And you see till October 2018 what they did with Daimler. Thank you for your listening me. I am now able to answer to the question and answer. I am very, very confused for the quality of the connection. And please, if Tommaso, you can be the moderator, I would be happy to answer to some questions.
Yes, of course. And do not worry, we follow most of your presentation very well. There were a couple of interruptions, but I think overall, apart from some glitches here and there, we got everything that you wanted to say, and it was really, really interesting. And thank you again very much for your keynote speech. I propose that you stop sharing the screen because I think that takes some data away from you. But eventually, if in the reply you want to activate back, you will have the possibility to do so. I think that we didn't get any, the question in the chat, this is something that we need to push a little bit further. So I propose that we just open the floor. We have like more than 30 minutes of time, so we can take a first round of questions. So please, people, just raise your hands or ask in the chat if you want to talk. And please keep the questions short so that we can have many questions and a rich exchange. And of course, if there are no questions coming in the next 20 seconds, I will start right now to ask questions because I have many. Okay, so I let Lorenza and Sebastian take note of those who want to ask questions. And I will start, I will break the ice. So I was very interested by many of the things you said, and clearly we can see this evolution towards more technological cars, and that is require electrification, connection, safety. Now, one of the topics that you didn't really talk in your presentation was the question of weight. Well, I'm going to talk about that because here recently in Gerpisa and also with other colleagues, we've started to get interested in the fact that weight seems to have been like a forgotten dimension in the car, since we've seen in Europe, but also in other places, that the CO2 targets for the environment were weight-based, basically to protect premium brands. And this has created a sort of paradox that cars that needed to reduce CO2 emissions, they were getting more and more weight and more power. They were becoming more premium cars. And you have shown something related to that, the fact that when you need to, you have a kind of normative baseline, regulatory baseline that push the cars more towards premium products, and then why you need to standardize the things. But so my question was, is there something to do about weight? What do you think about these CO2 weight-based targets that have clearly favored premium brands, but they create cars that are not so environmental friendly because they're very heavy, they're very powerful, and then even for electric cars, that makes them less green. And when I was looking at the data about the accident, I was very surprised to see that some of the countries that have improved the most in the last 20 years were like not high wages countries or not the most technological advanced one, like Greece and Lithuania were on the top, while the US was very bad in terms of car accident. And so that seems that perhaps a low tech approach by reducing weight, reducing power, make more greener cars, even with some compromise, could be another way to go, rather than keeping adding weight and power to premium cars. So that would be my first question to you. Let's see if somebody else wants to add questions so we can have a first round.
Yeah, related to the weight, I think that when we are talking, it's different. What has more importance than before when we are talking about when we are going through electrification, weight is very, very important. But SCX, so SCX, yes, is becoming more and more important. Why? Because in fact, the more power you need to make the car move, without energy saving in the town or in fact from a long distance point of view or commuting point of view, penetration in the air is have a lot of importance. So you have to take, and what we can say is that all the trend which is bad, I can say, from weight point of view and SCX point of view is our four-wheel drive effect, I can say, or fashion, which has increased a lot and has participated to, in fact, the increase of CO2, because everybody that knows that there is a 20% difference in the consumption, but also from weight point of view. And when we are coming to electric cars, weight is very important when we are talking about moving the first seconds. And to do so, of course, the car has to compensate the weight of the battery. That's why premium cars want to use lithium ion, more energetic one, than LFP, which is less energetic, but less cost, less rare earth, etc. So which is more downside, which is more in line with downsizing the car, minimizing what is needed from materials, not only for the battery, but the whole car. And that's why I was saying that even the portfolio will change according to that, because it is much more linked to the usage than to the capability to the customer to pay or to just show off when you buy a car. And lightening the car is as the same importance than before. But what is even more important is to be sure that you are recycling and that you are, I can say, trying to have the best adequacy to the usage. The economical balance is putting a lot of pressure on the battery, never and on electric items, because in fact you saw that now electric items would go till 70% of the car, of the cost of the car. In that sense, because you have to comply with the whole cost, of course we don't want to put too much money to lighten the car on the classical aspects. But when you are going through a sort of minimization of the usage, you go to much more optimization. So I don't know, and I'm not sure, that for the classical parts, what would win? Is it optimization or is it innovation with new materials to be lightened? I think there is a fight between both. And I think that when we are using computers, optimization, digital activities, etc., I think that we go, because it is only IT system that we are using, OEMs will go much first to optimization and then to lighten with cost. Why? Because they have to deal with cost increase related to electric items. Batteries, you know that we are crossing the curves with LFP in 2023 with the ICE. So it's not today. Huh? Today, without incentive, we are not currently profitable. So we cross the curves at that time. Even for batteries, for electric items, power electronics and semiconductors, everybody knows about what is coming. And in fact, it increases the cost. Same for materials. So steel is now much more costly. So I think that first priority of OEMs would be on optimizing user usage, while energy is moving and switching to a green energy to get the steel or to get materials. I am clear, Tommaso, for you?
Yes, you were very clear. Thank you very much. We will take other questions. If eventually, just by curiosity, when the weight-based targets, you know, the targets of CO2 that that give, according to the weight, different targets were introduced in 2007. Did Renault fight against that or did they accept?
Yeah. In fact, we fight with the weight as far as we don't have to change the category of brakes and the chassis parts. If you are changing the category, from platform perspective, if you are changing the category of brakes to be used or chassis parts to be used because you are heavier, in fact, it is very, very bad. So that's why I'm talking about optimization in a range. But I'm not sure that OEMs, especially, I can say generalist will pay a lot for switching materials, except when we go to renewal, because it would be a new measurement of total life, I can say, life cycle assessment. And it will happen not only on the battery, but also it will happen for all the materials. And those new metrics would drive. But for the car, weight is related to category of brakes and chassis parts. And by as a consequence, the power of the engine. But the engine power is much less than costly than a battery. And BMS, you can change a battery management system for the powertrain. It is much easier.
Okay, thank you very much for your answer. There was a question by Margherita Russo. If you want to take the floor, Margherita, and ask the question yourself.
Oh, thank you. Now, my question, thank you very much. There was a lot of suspense and great interest in your presentation. And I have a question on the conclusion of your presentation with respect to the ecosystems. And in particular, following your presentation, I was captured by an increasing in set of interrelations among the different actors you were mentioning in the different domains, in the production of components related to batteries, to the OEMs. With the conclusion on the ecosystems, to some extent, it seems that there are less integrated domains. Is it true, or it was just a way of representing the expansion of the domain of actions of the OEMs, in the sense that they have to encompass much more connections in their ecosystem? And if it is the case, which are the needs of connections between ecosystems? Are they cannot develop it on their own, as I imagine from what you said.
You are perfectly right. In fact, there is a difference between battery suppliers, because the battery is a new, I can say, component in our core value chain. Basically, it's a fact. It is a new core, an extended core. From ecosystem point of view, in fact, what we saw is that if each ecosystem wants to develop it by itself, I can take the example of Orange, for example, or telco system, they can say that 5G is coming, so you can have more easier TV. They can do the job for the connection to the V2X. But in fact, if they are not taking into account what safety means for a car point of view, they cannot do it. And I think that the safety of a mobility system is something that they have to take into account in order that we provide a common answer. Currently, what I show on this slide is the fact that each, region is trying to build its own ecosystem. Maybe it is a solution, provided the fact that all the users of the infrastructure are sharing all the standards to be used. Why? Because it is not possible to build business if you are not sharing the global common resources. In that sense, resources is the infrastructure, the road and the street, etc. till now, we have enough space to have dedicated lines for the bus, dedicated line for the roads. But now we are merging all as far as the traffic and the density of the traffic is increasing. If you don't share the standards and the way to use this infrastructure, we would not be able to live together, but to be complementary in the needs of the society. In order to be complementary in the needs of the society, transportation and car industry is a mass industry. If you don't have the volume effect, you cannot make it profitable. You cannot develop, or it is a sort of a transportation which is changing completely. You cannot develop for each town, in fact, the ecosystem which is dedicated to the town. So we must share this kind of thing. And what we are seeing today is that according to the countries and the geography and the culture and the way and the money they have to invest, in fact, the progress is not the same at all. What we can see in US is, for example, they are not talking about, they are now studying how to be together, public transportation and roads. But it is very, very recent. It is something that in Europe is discussed. But currently, they are still in silos. And what is different in China is that they are not in silos because the government is saying to them that they have to follow that. But silos cannot lead to new mobility and smooth mobility because it is the opposite of intermobility. It is the opposite. So if you are not sharing a sort of ecosystem with the norms, with the standards of communication, with the organization in order to take the decision of the traffic, etc., you cannot succeed. Or it would be too costly. It is it could lead to a sort of a Waymo car, which is a Waymo is a very, very expensive car that you cannot afford from a passenger point of view. That's why they are late, on top of technical difficulties. And putting a lot of lidars, etc., in your car is not the way to succeed. It is not, the tree is too big. And to do that, you have to decrease and you have to share usage for better usage and also in that sense for less cost. But currently, what is a sort of a headache is the profitability of such an ecosystem. And without incentive from the government, it's very difficult. It was the same for electric cars. Since government didn't give incentive to change the mobility in Europe, it was not moving. Why it is not moving in Japan? Because there is no incentive. If there is incentive from the government for more public transportation, using cars and mixing, I can say, vehicles on the same road using the same infrastructure, we will find a sort of a business model. But we have to help. That's why in the current initiative of Europe, called the Data for Safety, you saw that you have not only companies, but also governments that are involved in the initiative. What is not so well, I can say, we do not deal well with, is the fact that we didn't incorporate or encompass transport of goods. And Cavnew in US is doing that. Because in fact, you have to use the same road in order to deliver the goods. It is the COVID effect. And you use the same road to transport the people. So if you don't think the global ecosystem without that, you will miss something. It's okay?
Yes, thank you very much. Thank you. That was a very comprehensive question. And you answer, I think, a lot of other questions that might have been asked about the role of the state, of governments, and the obstacles towards this new ecosystem of mobility and connecting all these different technologies. So I think that was a very good question. So also, I don't know if there are other questions. I was just also thinking about all the difficulties in the sense that, of course, the car has always been surrounded by infrastructure because it's always been road, it's always been petrol stations and the insurance systems and the driving license. So it's not new. The car has always been surrounded by infrastructure and services. But what is new is this interconnectivity in real time and the standardization of all the different interfaces in order to make it work. And as you said, for an industry that is a mass producer of cars and which cost is decisive, if you need to standardize all these different interfaces in order to find a business model. But that is very difficult because that would imply that all the OEMs share the same kind of projects or technologies, that all the new players agree on that. So I think this is a big challenge for an organization like yours or for all the organizations that exist of cooperation between OEMs to find a way to, how much do you open your technology? How much do you keep it closed? And how do you find this way of standardizing? What do you see from the perspective of somebody who has worked so long with an OEM? Do you think that, I remember a paper, for example, on cybersecurity and that we had in one of our special number of the colloquium. We didn't have much, but we had at least one. And it said clearly that there is no cooperation between most of the OEMs on cybersecurity because it's a tricky issue that you don't want to share a lot of information on that. So what's your point of view on the perspective of overcoming all these technical challenges about creating this common infrastructure and standards? It seems difficult from an external point of view.
And
there is also a question by Calabrese. Giulio Calabrese is the chief editor of the review I just was talking about. So I let Giulio also ask a question. So we collect a last round of questions because we are approaching the closing time for the plenary. So I just give the word to you.
Okay. Thank you for your presentation. I hope that you will share your slides with us so we have more chance to see your presentation. I'm chair of a section, and it's very strange that we have two presentations from two young guys, and they both start from the same point of view, and they say that there is no reason to have large cars with large batteries because it's better to use electrical vehicles in the city, and in the other cases, they propose two different solutions, and I'd ask you what you think about it. The first one, a French guy, say that it's better to invest more in ultra-charged station system than in large batteries, and with their very interesting analysis. And the other guy from Japan say that is there no reason to invest in large car and large batteries, but it's better to invest in fuel cells for larger cars, trucks, and buses. Which will be your reply to these two young researchers?
I can reply with a third solution, which is you use the road in order to recharge the battery with dynamic charging. This is also a solution. When you are commuting, you could use on a long travel, I can say, the highway on a dedicated line in order to recharge or around the town. So I think that it depends on the what the infrastructure is going wants to do. Fuel cell. I show the example of the Mirai compared to the Tesla 3. Currently, the cost of Mirai is much more expensive than Tesla 3. according to the maturity of the technology, according to the availability of the hydrogen compared to the battery and the electricity. So I think that we can have dreams about what is coming next, because in fact, the new technology is always is withdrawing the, I can say, the disadvantages of the current one, and is providing another one. So I think that we must be very, we have to take into account the timeline. And I think that when we put, when you put the technology in a timeline perspective, you have much more agreement between the people than when we are talking without that. And we are, so that we have to take into account the maturity of each technology. For sure, we will have hydrogen on our roads in 2050, for sure. But maybe less obvious in 2030. Except maybe for a sort of a dedicated ODD of usage. So I think that this timeline and this maturity that is directly related to the cost and the process engineering of this technology is something that could help to define the right timeline. Personally, I think that having a sort of dynamic charging in some areas could be a very good solution, because now what we can see is that the train is the most effective from CO2 point of view. Dynamic charging is a sort of train technology adapted to the car. But it is a 1 million euro a kilometer. And it is investments. That's why it depends on the context. We have also e-fuels that could be used. So maturity for cost efficiency is something very, very, very important. And maybe maturity for hydrogen could come earlier in Asia, where there is no nuclear energy, et cetera, et cetera. And I think it's not only related to car industry, it is also related to energy industry. And we have to take that into account as an input, I can say. But in, you know, in car industry, changing is very, not fast, but deep. And it is changing. And what is complicated is to achieve a sort of a maturity. That's why we are all what we see is that from a design perspective, it is a sort of a booming of all the ideas and all the technologies. But putting the technologies in the street is something which is much more longer term. In fact, as a massive solution. So take the timeline into account and we will find an agreement. Okay.
Thank you very much. The concerning my question about
regulation and standardization. Yeah. I think that it is a real issue. Because the technologies are new, I think OEMs are reluctant to share because they don't have the experience. I don't think that they really want to keep it for themselves. I think that the lack of experience is leading to a lack of share. Regarding cybersecurity, what I can say is that I never saw an ISO norm being adopted worldwide so quickly. In fact, the US proposed the norm for cybersecurity. It has been adopted by all the countries simultaneously. So I think that each time they see the interest, and seeing without any consequences on their business model, they are collaborating. Regarding cyber, in fact, as it is related to the safety of the car, we are dealing with some tricky issue with the OEMs, and I think, and I was in that case, they are very, I can say, angry on the fact that if they share, maybe their weaknesses will be more visible. And regarding cyber, it is not at all what we have to do. So I think that in that sense, we have to share more the, I can say, the constraints, so the regulation. We have to do by regulation. Because in fact, nobody would say. It is the opposite for charging. For charging, I think that I think that no need to not to share the way we charge. Problem is not the technology to charge, CHAdeMO, etc. It's not the issue. The issue is what we are doing with. And what the issue is the fact that you have a battery cheaper or charger cheaper, and what is the technology, and it depends on the context. Of course, when you have a vertical housing, such as in China, you need much more quicker charge than in the US or in the landscape in England or in Germany or in France, where you have your personal home and you can charge all the night. Because you have a private household. So I think it must be a technique could be shared. Because when we are looking at the road from charging point of view, it is the same question as the roads, as the physical roads. It is a sort of channel you have to use. And it could be different. So you have highways on the roads, so you can have very quick charging if you are in a building or in the center of a city, or it could be smaller, less charging, less speed for charging point of view, and it will be cheaper for the car if you are not in the same context in the countryside. But at the end, and it is like a sort of little road that you are using. So I think that for this kind of thing, we could share much more. 5G, I think, I'm not a telco in the telco industry, but I think that from a telco industry, I don't know what is the problem of sovereignty of each country. But from auto industry perspective, there is no issue of sharing. We just want to have the same interface for mobile edge computing when we are gathering all the information related to the traffic, related to emergency calling, etc., than for other troubles. And when we are entering into services, we are entering, and the platform, we are entering in a competitive world, but not the previous one.
Thank you very much, Nadine. I propose to kind of make an applause virtually. I know there are different ways to do that, but we really appreciate your presentation. Your answers were really extremely argumented and clear. So I knew already, I had the opportunity to assist the other presentation by you. So thank you again. And I think we all have heard your message that Physita is looking for new opportunities to cooperate with university laboratory and researchers. So we will definitely spread the new and looking forward to cooperate with you on more specific projects and future ideas. So thank you again very much.
And if you
want to hang around in the colloquium and ask questions in the parallel session and so on, you're of course very welcome, but I guess you're also very busy. But anyway, thank you again very much.
Thank you for all, and don't hesitate if you have some question, you have my email and we will be pleased to answer or to cooperate. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay, so while we now to a short break of 15 minutes, and then we will start again with the parallel sessions. And you will see on the bottom, you have the breakout rooms that for the time being, you don't have, you just have a test in one room, but we will create three rooms for the parallel session. And you will be able to click on the parallel session you want to go in to join the parallel session. So this will be ready when you come back. So I propose now to close this first plenary session and to reconvene in 5 minutes in this same meeting. So you can keep the connection open.